God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. The Lord be with you. Welcome, everyone, as we gather for our worship for the fourth Sunday after Pentecost. And we welcome those who are joining us online. Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, we who were baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death. We pray that as you raised him from death, so by the power of the Holy Spirit, we may live the new life to your glory, knowing ourselves to be dead in sin, but alive for you in Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the scripture.
A reading from the book of Genesis. The child Isaac grew and was weaned, and Abraham made a great feast on the day that Isaac was weaned. But Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out this slave woman with her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son Isaac." The matter was very distressing to Abraham on account of his son. But God said to Abraham, "Do not be distressed because of the boy and because of your slave woman. Whatever Sarah says to you, do as she tells you, for it is through Isaac that offspring shall be named after you. As for the son of the slave woman, I will make a nation of him also, because he is your offspring." So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. As she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba, when the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite him, a good way off, about the distance of a bow shot. For she said, "Do not let me look on the death of the child." And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept. And God heard the voice of the boy. And the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, "What troubles you, Hagar? Do not be afraid, for God has heard the voice of the boy where he is. Come, lift up the boy and hold him fast with your hand, for I will make a great nation of him." Then God opened her eyes, and she saw a well of water. She went and filled the skin with water and gave the boy a drink. God was with the boy and he grew up. He lived in the wilderness and became an expert with the bow. He lived in the wilderness of Paran, and his mother got a wife for him from the land of Egypt. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. Should we continue in sin in order that grace may abound? By no means. How can we who died to sin go on living in it? Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? Therefore we have been buried with him by baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too might walk in newness of life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we will certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him, so that the body of sin might be destroyed, and we might no longer be enslaved to sin. For whoever has died is freed from sin. But if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. The death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also must consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. For the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
The fact that Hagar sat down opposite him, a about the distance of a bow shot, suggests that she could still see him, but was too far away to hear his cries. So in a sense, this was not abandonment of the child, but was the grief of a person oppressed and abandoned herself, with nothing left to do but to grieve over what had been lost and what she thought would never be. Even though it was Hagar who cried out, the writer tells us that God heard the voice of the boy. The Genesis storyteller uses an amusing wordplay on Ishmael's name, which means God hears, saying God heard the boy crying, which is something like saying God heard the boy named God hears. Never say the Bible doesn't have humour. The same word is used here that is used in the Exodus narrative to describe God hearing the cries of the oppressed. I have heard, observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry. It would seem that in the writings of the Old Testament, the Israelites concluded that it is in the character of God to hear the cries of the weak and the oppressed, and to act to deliver them. And so God was acting in character in his deliverance of Hagar. We are told that Hagar is shown, or has her eyes opened, and sees a well which provides life-giving water for Hagar and Ishmael. But then God made an extraordinary promise to Hagar that is almost identical to the promise made to Abraham. I will make him into a great nation. The promise is not just for Isaac, it is for Abraham's other son as well. The reading concludes with the rather mundane observation about Ishmael growing up, settling down and taking a wife. Yet that simple comment tells us that while God's promise for Isaac continued, Abraham's other son would also be the bearer of a promise and a future. Traditionally, Ishmael is considered the ancestor of the Arab tribes of the southern area of Palestine. But Muslims also trace their ancestry to Abraham through Ishmael. So what are we to make of this sordid little tale? A tale that could come out of a television program. In a way, it's its own sort of dynasty. And a tale where the joy of laughter turns into the anger of oppression. Well, the two parts of the story offer us two different paths. Firstly, it is clear that human beings on their own have a tendency to muck things up in the most terrible ways. This story is a warning against the human tendency to accept a gift from God and then to act as if it were our own to defend and protect at all costs, even at the cost of other people who are made in God's image. Sometimes this masquerades as defending the faith, as an attempt to protect the faith by excluding all those who disagree, often in some narrow doctrinal matter. All through the biblical traditions, the tendency to make the gifts of God into personal privilege crops up again and again. And unfortunately, this tendency has continued in the major world religions down through the centuries, even to our times. the circles that we draw to protect what we think is ours, often can end up excluding the very ones whom God wants to enter. And so we end up oppressing others as we justify our own behaviour toward them on the grounds that we have the gift and they don't. The implications this story raises for how we see God's care for people in the world that live outside of our cosy little cohort are significant. The other issue raised by this reading is that God is still the God of the weak and oppressed, because he is the God who sees and hears. Ishmael bears a name that signals a promise to every human being. God is not deaf, dumb, or blind. God is not hard-hearted, cold, or detached. God is consistently portrayed in the biblical traditions as the God of all peoples, and as the God who acts for deliverance in the world in ways that go beyond what we might expect. This is an ancient story, and yet how current it is, offering a lesson that we unfortunately still have yet to learn. The Lord be with you. In our orders of service, we turn to page 7. We stand and let us together affirm the faith of the Church. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us, for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate in the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified and crucified. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in our holy Catholic and apostolic Church. We acknowledge love and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us pray for the world and the Church.
Loving and merciful God, you care for your people and all your children are precious in your sight. We pray for all the family of the nations. We pray for all whose lives are torn apart by war and conflict. As we continue to pray for the people of Ukraine, Russia, Sudan, Israel and Palestine, and for peace and goodwill among Jews, Christians and Muslims throughout the world. Loving God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving and merciful God, you offer your people redemption and fullness of love. We pray for your church throughout the world. Within the Anglican Church of Australia, we pray today for Bishop Greg Anderson and for the clergy and people of the Diocese of the Northern Territory, for the Very Reverend Rob Llewellyn, and the clergy and people of Christ Church Cathedral, Darwin. Within our own diocese, we pray for Clarence, our bishop, and today for the parochial district of Yacadana, for priest in charge, Matthew Peary, honorary deacon, Heather Matthews, and for the parish leaders and congregations of Holy Trinity, Yacadana, St. Mark's, Keeler, St. Andrew's, Dendering, St. Paul's, Allen's Flat, and St. Aidan's, Toowoomba. Loving God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving and merciful God, you are good and forgiving, and you abound in steadfast love for your people. We pray for our community. We pray for our families, our neighbours, and our friends, and for all whom we meet in our daily lives. We pray for all those who struggle to repay their mortgages, or who struggle to meet the basic needs of their families for food and shelter due to the current cost of living crisis. Loving God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving and merciful God, you are filled with compassion for your people, and in our troubles you hear our cries. We pray for all in need, for the sick, and for all who care for them. We pray for all those on our parish list of prayer, for those who have no one to pray for them, and for those whose pain and suffering is unnoticed by those around them. We pray for survivors of violence, abuse, and neglect. Heal their wounds, free them from fear, and turn the hearts of those who abuse them from their evil. Loving God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving and merciful God, you deliver your people from death and promise us the joys of everlasting life. We pray for all who have died in your love. Help us to love you above all else, that united with all your saints, we may be raised to a joyful resurrection and be with you forever. Loving God, in your mercy,
hear our prayer. Loving God, we bring to you now our own prayers. Almighty God, you have promised to hear our prayers. Grant that what we have asked in faith, we may by your grace receive it, through Jesus Christ. We are the body of Christ. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Blessed are you, Lord God of all creation. With grateful thanks we offer our gifts in this bread and wine, fruits of your earth and of our labour, signs of your redemptive purpose for our lives and for all creation. Blessed be God forever. Like incense, my prayer rises to meet you. My arms stretch out, lifting me high. The merciful love of the Lord fills the earth. By the word of the Lord, the heavens were made. Like incense, my prayer rises to meet you. Christ has been sacrificed for us. For the sake of his flock, he was willing to endure death. Like incense, my prayer rises to meet you. My arms stretch out, lifting me up. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Give them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord. We praise you that through your eternal word, you brought the universe into being and made us in your own image. You have given us this earth to care for and delight in, and with its bounty you preserve our life. We thank you that you bound yourself to the human race with the promises of a gracious covenant and called us to serve you in love and peace. Above all, we give you thanks for your Son, our Saviour Jesus Christ. Born as one of us, he lived our common life and offered his life to you in perfect obedience and trust. By his death he delivered us from sin, brought us new life, and reconciled us to you and to one another. Therefore, with angels and archangels, with apostles and prophets, with holy men and women of every age, we proclaim your great and glorious name. Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Amen.
himself made once for all upon the cross, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming again, we celebrate with this bread and this cup his one perfect and sufficient sacrifice for the sins of the whole world. As we eat and drink this holy sacrament, renew us by your Spirit, that we may be united in the body of your Son, and serve you as a royal priesthood in the joy of your eternal kingdom. Receive our praises, Father, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, with whom and in him, by the power of the Holy Spirit, we worship you in songs of never-ending praise. Thank you. Almighty and eternal God, may we who have received this sacrament of your Son's body and blood worship you in all we do, proclaim your word to all the world, and live in the power of your Spirit. Father, we offer ourselves to you as living sacrifice, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and pray to your praise and glory. Just a reminder that I'm going on an annual leave as of this afternoon. Stephanie and I unfortunately won't be staying around for morning tea. We've got to head off to Melbourne for the provincial evensong this afternoon, so we'll have to get on our way early, unfortunately, so we can't join with you in morning tea this morning. Thank you to clergy who are looking after various church worship during my absence. Reverend Maureen Beattie on Wednesday the 28th. The next Sunday you'll have the very Reverend Sharon Nell, Dean of the Diocese of Port Elizabeth, who's staying here in the close as part of the Bishop's sabbatical program. She'll be looking after you next Sunday. And then on the following Sunday, Father David Still will be presiding and preaching. If you'd like to help out with any of the odd jobs during my leave, as I'm heading off straight away, just send me a text and we'll arrange for you to be able to get in and to do the odd jobs if you're able to. And there's also notices there about the winter appeal and parish council. Thank you to the cathedral singers who will be looking after music during school holidays. But it was good to see Hannah here again this morning as well. If there's any questions, ask me at the door as you leave. Would you please stand for our post-communion hymn?
Thank you.
the peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. In the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen.